Yeah, good morning.
The last time in the last session, what we have discussed was an infinite series generated by a sequence xn, and how we have derived the series is just let's say quick review here that if you have been given x equals to xn sequence, and then you can write the corresponding infinite series. So how? So we means writing in terms of partial sums. So we have defined first partial sum is the first term itself. Then second partial sum is the first partial sum plus the next term, that is x to here. Then third partial sum is as the previous partial sum, second partial sum plus x3. And if you write them explicitly, that is first, so second partial sum is the sum of the first two terms in the sequence. Then third partial sum is first three terms in the sequence, and so on. So if you write the kth partial sum or nth partial sum is Sn minus 1 plus Xn, and in the expanded form, it is going to be X1 plus X2 plus and so on plus Xn minus 1 plus Xn. Then we have defined the corresponding the convert. So you have generated a one new sequence. Okay, this is known as nth partial sum of the infinite series, which we have denoted by summation xn. The infinite series is denoted by this, where this sometime this also is used as a notation, where it is understood that n is starting from n equals to 1 to infinity. So this you treat as a symbol to write to define this is x1 plus x2 plus x3 plus and so on dot dot dot. It's an infinite series. Okay, and then if this series converges, that we are going to show. So how will we decide the convergence of the infinite series is completely depends on the convergence of the sequence of nth partial sums. So if this sequence converges, since you are starting from S1, S2, S3, and so on, you have generated new sequence. If this sequence converges, and let the sequence limit is capital S, then you will say this is equals to S, which is limit of the nth partial sum sequence. Okay, so this is questionable. So when this happens, then whenever this sequence is converges, okay, then we are allowed to write this summation n equals to 1 to infinity xn equals to s. So now later on you will also realize, so one whenever you have suppose you have a sum of two functions, okay, and you have performed the integration there. So how will you perform the integration? You can perform the integration individual function and then add, right? Similarly, you can also apply for the finitely many functions. So if you recall, if you have sum of two functions, let's say f is equals to f1 plus f2. Okay, so this is abuse notation, so which means it is f of x equals to f1 of x plus f2 of x. Or you let's say till n sum, okay, n number of functions you can perform the sum. So obviously it is understood that they are defined on the their common domain. Okay, so further, if you want to evaluate the integration or differentiation with respect to x, you can certainly go for the individual integration f y of x dx and then perform the sum. So 1 to n. So finitely many. So these things are allowed. Means the interchange of summation and integral. But the things will not be same when you have the function f, or you have the sub, you, if you define the function as f1 of x plus f2 of x plus and so on. Means if you have defined this y infinite series n equals to 1 to infinity fi of x, then if you want to perform the integration f of x dx, so then you can integrate this is equals to summation n equals to 1 to n infinity fi of x dx. Now, like previously in the finite sum, whether it means like you have done the interchange of this, means some term wise integration you have done and then you have performed the sum. Okay, but whether, so this is up to, this is okay whenever this whenever we are writing f of x equals to this, means it's understood that it's a convergent. Okay, means infinite series, this is convergent. More than that, we don't know. Means it has a some infinite limit this. Okay, but the thing is whether this can be written as summation n equals to 1 to infinity integration fi of x dx or not. That is a questionable thing. So they, whether they always be remaining same or they are going to be different. So this is a questionable whenever you are performing the infinite sum. So these answers you will find later on. Okay, maybe in this course or maybe the course when you do deal with the course name like such as real analysis and so on. I just want to mention here that whatever you have utilized the freedom like interchange of summation and integration for really many terms. Okay, so these things are not available for the infinite sum. Okay, with you need to have some additional properties. Okay, right. Now, further, means we have also learned the some of the properties of infinite series. Okay, some of the properties of the infinite series, such as, so if you have the given sequence x equals to xn, and then you have generated a series, so this Sn is equals to summation xi, I is equals to 1 to n. Nth partial sum and limit of Sn exists and that is equals to S, and that you are identified as summation I equals to 1 to infinity xi. So these are dummy indexes, so I is dummy index, so you can replace it by n as well, not a problem. Okay, so what can we observe from here? That property is, first property what we have learned is limit of this sequence xi or xn must be zero. So whenever this infinite series converges, okay, then the limit of the given sequence, okay, that is going to be zero. Okay, so this, the proof was very simple here. Okay, that we have already learned. Okay, so Sn converges, so you have this limit of Sn is S. And limit of, you can say the next Sn plus 1 is equals to S. Or you can start with Sn minus 1 and Sn. Okay. Since suppose this we have given that limit of Sn is S. So whether you talk about Sn minus 1 of term or Sn plus 1 of term or Sn, so nearby terms, they are for large value, they are remain the same. That's what meaning of convergence here. Then if you write what is Xn is Sn minus Sn minus 1. And now since you can use the algebra of the limits now, this series, this sequence converges to S, this sequence converges to S. So this the difference will converge to the difference of the limits that we have already learned, that is equals to zero as n tends to infinity. Okay, so that's the very first property we have for the convergence of the infinite series if it is given. then we have the property that seeker's limit, that limit of the original sequence xn is going to be zero. So it turns out to be a necessary condition. So like if this series infinite series converges, its nth term will tends to zero as n tends to infinity. But converse may or may not hold. So for that we have already seen an example of harmonic series summation 1 by n n equals to 1 to infinity. Okay, so that we have seen that series was not convergent, but its nth term was tending to zero. So, but once you want to show that the series generated by a given sequence does not converge, show that the limit of the nth term is going to be non-zero. Okay, so for example, so let x equals to r to the power n, and let's say mod r is greater than or equal to 1. Okay, now the series generated, so as nth partial sum, if you write, that is going to be summation I equals to 1 to n r to the power I. Now not that limit of r to the power n does not equals to zero, because for mod r greater than equals to 1, it will never tends to zero. It will never cross to from the left of, you can say, on the left side of 1. Okay, right. So that we have already seen that limit of r to the power n will not never tend to zero whenever mod r is greater than equals to 1. So this certainly implies that this infinite series I equals to or n equals to 1 to infinity r to the power n does not converge. It's a one line answer now by using the definition of the necessary condition for the convergence of the infinite series. If you are able to show that the nth term does not converge to zero as n tends to infinity, then it's the generated series will never be converged. Okay, so let's try to take a more insight about the infinite series by looking at some comparison test. See, sometime like in the sequences also, okay, we have tried to write down the comparison test. Means we have tried to identify two simple sequences, okay, which are lies like a lower bound and upper bound for nth term. Okay, and then we try to see whether both bounds are tending to the same limit. Then the Sandwich theorem tells you that the in the middle limit will also be the same, and that also converges. So similarly, we can also extend that result here or not, or what are other comparison tests available, okay, that we are going to look at now. Okay, right. So that's the first result. We have seen already the series generated by xn converges, then limit of xn is zero. That we have just now seen. Now another thing is Cauchy criterion for series. So once you have the series summation xn converges if and only for every epsilon there exists so and so. This is a Cauchy criterion, if you recall. So you take any pair of m and nth term, and if you take the difference, that will be certainly lies closer to each other after certain stage. That's what the Cauchy criterion tells you. Okay, so let me write few steps about it. Okay, so first is given, let the summation xn converges. What does it mean? That means that limit of that nth partial sum converges. That's what it means, right? Now, since this is a limit of the sequence of real numbers, so then you know that in a Cauchy convergence criteria in the real number, we know that the sequence converges if and only it is Cauchy. So implies limit SN converges. That now this is if and only if SN is Cauchy. Okay, that's what the result is, right? So now let's see, look at some examples. So that we have already seen, the geometric series diverges if mod r is greater than or equals to 1 just now, because nth term does not tends to 0. Then the harmonic series diverges, summation 1 by n diverges. See, there are multiple proof available for showing that the harmonic series diverges. So you can explore one more proof that is also given in the book as well, reference book as well, that how this that harmonic series diverges. Why? Okay, means they have proved by using the contradiction. Okay, suppose it is converges, then you have reached as some absurd situation, you can say, which never be true. So then you can say that your assumption is wrong, and this is how the result will follow. Or else you can use the previous result. Okay, that we have shown that that x you look at that if s2n is greater than you can say was if I recall that is going to be 1 plus n by 2, some 2 to the power n. Okay, if you recall from the previous proof, we have shown that the s2nth term is always greater than 1 plus n by 2, and when this series diverges, this sequence diverges, so obviously this sequence diverges. Okay, because here n is sitting in the numerator. Okay, this tends to infinity as n tends to infinity, so that is why this also tends to infinity. Okay, now the next very next result is the alternating harmonic series converges. Okay, so that we are going to prove now. Okay, meanwhile we are going to have this as a test, p test. This fourth is known as p test for infinite series. Means if you have the series of the form 1 by n to the power some number p, okay, p is some real number. Okay, so whenever p is suppose equals to 0 or less than 0, so you have the n to the power some positive only. Okay, it's not so. If you have let's say p is equals to 0, it is summation 1. So 1 is, it's not like 1 to the power, it's always summation 1 infinite times, so it's definitely diverges. So whenever you have p is, it's here is p equals to 0, p equals to 0, then this nth term is 1, which is definitely does not converge to 0. So by using that necessity of the convergence of the infinite series, you can claim that that series does not converge. Now when p is less than 0, you have n to the power minus p, the nth term, so minus also does not tends to 0 as n tends to infinity. Okay, so that use that will guarantee that this series diverges whenever p less than equals to 0. Okay, now what about here, if you have you have also seen that whenever p equals to 1, so this becomes a harmonic series that we have already shown that diverges. So p equals to 1 diverges. So what about the values between 0 to 1 and more than 1? What can we tell about? So now see, this we are assumed that as a p test, so which we are going to use it as it is. So converges when p is greater than 1, so whenever the index or power of the denominator in this n to the power, okay, is more than 1, greater than 1, then we have the p test confirms that this series converges. And if you have the number between p, the power between 0 to 1, then it is diverges. Okay, so here from here by using p test, you can directly refer the p test. So then summation like 1 by root n. So p is, if you compare with this, p equals to half, but half is less than 1. So p test implies this series diverges. If you have summation 1 by n to the power 3 by 2, okay, so 3 by 2 is more than 1. So this p test implies that the series is converges. Okay, like this, you can use the p test now. 1 by n to the power, let's say you have some 1 by 4. Okay, so this series diverges because p is less than 1 and greater than 0. Okay, and so on. So this is how you will apply the p test here. Okay, so this proof we are also skipping here because we have not gone for the subsequences. So proof is related with the subsequences. So, but if you are interested, you can certainly go in the reference and look at the proof. If you are not able to understand that, you can let me know. I will explain in the either in the next class or a separate detailed sheet or separate discussion will be there. Okay, so let's try to cover this result that the alternating harmonic series converges. Okay, so we are in, proving the result that this alternating harmonic series, so n equals to 1 to infinity minus 1 to the power n plus 1 by n converges. That we want to show. Now what we want to do here is, so we are going to look at the nth partial sum. So Sn is going to be, you have, this is going to be summation I equals to 1 to n. This is I equals to 1 to n minus 1 to the power I plus 1 divided by n, divided by I. Right, this is a nth partial sum. Okay, now it completely depends on the whether it is even number or odd number. So nth place is either even place or odd place. So if n is even, so means then that you have is n equals to 2k, right? For some k belongs to natural number, right? So then, and as 2k, if you write, that's going to be 1 minus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 3 minus 1 by 4 plus and so on. What will be the ending term here is 1 by 2k minus 1 minus 1 by 2k, if you follow the pattern here. Okay, so if you look at here S2, what is that? 1 minus 1 by 2, that is 1 by 1 minus 1 by 2. If you look at for S4, that is 1 minus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 3 minus 1 by 4. So if you look at the k value, is starting from 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on till k. Okay, so this is the S2k. Okay, now if you look at all the pairs here now, look at the pair individually, they all are positive, even strictly positive. So this is always greater than 0, right? Is there any doubt about it? Greater than 0? Because each individual place is greater than 0, sum of the positive number is positive. Okay, this will never be negative. You have, I can rewrite the terms as S2k is equals to 1 minus 1 by 2 minus 1 by 3. Okay, minus 1 by 4 minus 1 by 5 plus and so on. So what you will remain with here is with the minus and so on, that is going to be minus, if I write here the previous one term here, so that we will be able to look at clearly, that's going to be plus 1 by 2k minus 3 minus 1 by 2k minus 2 plus 1 upon 2k minus 1 minus 1 by 2k. Right, so we have adjust this term, right? So we have going to be adjust with this. So minus 1 by 2k minus 2 minus 1 by 2k minus 1 minus 1 by 2k, that is remaining. So all terms are positive here, okay? And it is difference with 1 minus, okay? 1 minus this entire term will remain positive. Okay, so you can make it like you have, instead of this, now you can make it like this, and which is here plus now. Okay, and this is certainly a positive number, so 1 minus this will definitely less than equals to 1. Okay, now see, this is always greater than 0. Okay, so this sequence is bounded. Okay, so this sequence S2K, whenever n is even, this is this sequence is bounded between 0 to 1. Okay, now similarly you can show that the next term, if you have the next term, the next term is S2K plus 1. If you write down, it is going to be 1 minus 1 by 2 1 by 3 minus 1 by 4. See, S2K plus 1 means next term of it. Means you are going to add that 1 by 2K plus 1. Okay, then if you going to arrange minus L 1 minus 1 by 2 minus 1 by 3. So I am just writing this in this fashion now. Okay, right. So S2K plus 1 is equals to, you have, I'm just writing in the previous fashion. So 1 minus 1 by 2 minus 1 by 3 plus, minus 1 by 3, 1 by 4 minus 1 by 5 plus and so on, minus and so on, is going to be minus 1 by 2n minus 1 by 2n plus 1. That is going to be the next term, right? Because we are going to add here plus 1 by 2n plus 1, and minus 1 by 2n is already there. Okay, then this is going to be, because of this, we are using this k here, minus 1 by 2k minus 1 by 2k plus 1. So again, by the same argument, it is going to be less than equals to 1. Okay, and it always be greater than 0. By the similar argument, you can rearrange all the things here as 2k plus 1. If you rearrange, you can always see that is always positive. So again, by the same 1 minus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 3 minus 1 by 4 and so on, what is that is S2K plus 1 by 2K plus 1. If you recall, this is going to be the 2K plus 1 of partial sum. But since this is greater than 0, this is also greater than 0, so this is certainly greater than 0. So now what relation we have now? We have relation now is 0 less than S2K, which is less than S2K plus 1. Why? Because S2K plus 1 is S2K plus 1 by 2K plus 1. So it's definitely more than that. Is certainly less than equals to 1. Okay, now note that now if you look at the this sequences, S2K is bounded and S2K plus 1 is also bounded. Okay, there are two sequences, and you can extract odd even places, and you can extract for the odd places. Okay, now what is the behavior here for the odd places and even places is, okay, so if you consider this sequence S2K, you can show that it's going to be monotonically increasing sequence. Okay, so this symbol, Okay, we are going to use this as 2k is if you go up, it's monotonically increasing, and the sequence that even odd places is going to be monotonically decreasing sequence, and both are bounded. Okay, so which shows, so we have monotone convergence theorem tells you that if the sequence is monotone and bounded, that will definitely converge. Okay,
sir, if we think in another way, if we see that the term subtracting from one is getting increased step by step, so can't it the can't the value be decreased? So won't it be a decreasing function?
Which one?
Means it is keep on decreasing from one.
Would be monotonously decreasing function. Sorry, yeah. So
see, these each term individual, if you look at, they all are positive numbers.
Okay, sir, that's
right.
We understood, but I am talking about the last sentence term that we have separated, that like 1 minus
yes, yes. Huh. Yeah,
1 minus bracket. Okay, so that term is getting increased step by step, so the whole term is subtracting from 1.
Yeah.
So whenever the terms getting subtracted from anyone, that's a higher value, then it will decrease the whole function's value. So can't it be monotonically decreasing?
Sir, I think that the given function will neither be strictly increasing nor strictly decreasing.
Which function? Is like which S2K you're talking?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, why it is so?
So, sir, if we take S of 0, we get 1.
There is no S of 0.
So, S of 1, sorry.
S of 1 is odd place. So, it is not related with the odd place. Odd place is, you have this S2k plus 1. It's going to be it's odd place. So, S1 is going to be, yeah, 1, yes.
Then when we take S2, it will become 1 by 2.
Yeah.
Then when we take S of 3, 1 by 3 will be added. So first it was 1, then it was decreased, then it was increased again.
Okay, so what I will do is now is let's write down the explicitly some S1, S2, S3, S4. Okay, and let's try to look at the behavior. Okay, until S5. Okay, so if we write down S1. That is 1, right? Now, if you write down S2, that is 1 minus 1 by 2, that is 1 by 2. Okay. Now, let's write S3, that's going to be 1 minus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 3. So, that is going to be some 1 by 2 plus 1 by 3. So, it's
five
going to
six.
Be, you can say, you can say S2 plus 1 by 3. Okay, I'm just writing S2 because I know S2 is positive. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let's write S4. So S4 is 1 minus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 3 minus 1 by 4. Okay. So this is going to be, you have, this is S2. I'm just writing this. So this is going to be, you can say, I'm just rewriting it here. So let me, I don't want to write in this way. What I will write is S1 minus 1 by 2 minus 1 by 2.
Okay, okay, sir, you are talking about only even and odd
yes,
places at one
yes,
time.
Yes, 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 yes,
okay.
Yes. Okay, so S2 is, S4 is, I am writing this S2 plus E minus 1 by 4. Now, similarly, if you look at S5, is going to be, so S3 minus, you are going to have, you have, this is going to be minus 1 by 4 minus 1 by 5. Okay, and so on.
Yeah, so okay. The even terms are gradually increasing and
it,
odd
yes.
are decreasing. Okay.
Yes, yes. So S4, I'm just completing it. It is S4 plus, you have, this is 1 by 5 minus 1. So if you look at the odd places, it's going to be S1 greater than greater than S3, greater than S5, greater than S7, and so on. If you look at the even places, it's going to be S2 less than equals to less than S4, less than S6, less than S8. So you will find this behavior here. Okay, so you have two sub. You can say it's in other. There are two subsequences. Okay, one is odd place and one is even place. But if you not here that at means because we are talking about the large value of n. Okay, so the large value of n may be odd place or may be even place. So if both these sequences will converge and converge to the same limit. Okay, there are two things. If both these subsequences converge and converges to the same limit, so nth place will have chance of any one of them. Okay, so that will also behave in the similar way. Okay, did you get my point?
Okay, sir, we got it.
Okay, so yeah, so what was there is, so we have mentioned that as sequence with the odd even places will monotonically increase, and sequence with odd places will be monotonically decreasing, and they are bounded. So the monotone convergence theorem says that this both will converge. Okay, and okay, now also note that now, so we have also note that means like these both subsequences will be converging. Okay, so now what we want to claim now is monotone convergence theorem implies this S2k converges and S2k plus 1 converges. They are all expected with odd even places, they are expected with the odd places. S2k plus 1 is nothing but S2k plus 2k plus 1. Now, since this converges and this converges, let's say to limit some S. And this also converges the sequence, right? You know, the sequence converges to the zero. So both will converge. Okay, this will converge to the limit of S2k, which we will say some S, and this converges to zero as k tends to infinity. So then this implies limit of S2k plus 1 is same as the limit of S2k plus 0, but 0 will not contribute anything. So both of the sequence converges and converges to the same limit, let's say S. Then limit of Sn also converges, and that is going to be S only. Because large place, either it will be even number or odd number, but both will be behave in the similar manner when you take k as large as possible, because whatever the added term is there, it is negligible term, you can say, in other words. So S2k plus 1 and S2k in the limiting sense, they both behave same. So that is why we can claim that limit of Sn is S. Okay, so there are two things. So first thing is the subsequences both at odd place or even place converges, and they have been converged to the same limit. Then the original sequence will also be converging and converges to the same limit. Yes. Okay, so this proves that alternating harmonic series will be converging. Okay, now let's draw some comparison test here now. Okay,
sir, here
let's
can
see.
We say maximum of S2k will be equal to minimum of S2k minus S2k plus 1, because we have seen that if sequence is increasing, then its maximum would be equal to its limit.
very first thing I wish to correct here is whenever you have a set of infinitely many elements, about maximum and minimum, you can talk about supremum and infimum. Okay.
Supreme, yes.
Okay. So because this is very much necessary to understand the difference there. Okay. Right. So now see where this limit will converge. This if you have the decreasing sequence, okay, that it will converge to the infimum, right?
Infimum, yes.
Okay. So instead of that, what is the way this converge is infimum of the set S2K plus one. S2K is converges monotonically, and this is going to be in this increasing behavior.
Yes.
Okay, so it will converge to the supremum. Okay, so that also you can instead of this, they write this limit infimum and supremum both becomes the same thing here when it goes as k goes large. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Now let's look at some comparison test here. Okay, so you have been given with two sequences, let's say X and XY, two sequences, real sequences, and suppose you are able to identify means after some stage, means like it is not necessary that very first with X1 is less than equals to Y1 or X2 is less than equals to Y2 or something. So you can accept finitely many, you can say. In other words, suppose that this is true except for finitely many numbers. Yes, you can discard those numbers. Okay. Because you are talking about you are going to discuss about the behavior of the sequence at its large value. So you can discard some of the finitely many things which are not fitted in your current scenario, you can say in the comparison test. So if you are able to find out the relation between two sequences in such manner, this k may be 2, k may be 1, k may be 3, or 10 or 100 or 1000, whatever, but it's a natural number. So if you are able to find out such behavior here, then so if you look at here, see xn is always a non-negative sequence. That's very first thing here. Xn is a non-negative sequence of real numbers. Okay. Now, see, Xn has a lower bound. That is zero. Okay. The sequence has a lower bound. Zero. Yn also has a lower bound automatically because Yn is sitting on the above the Xn. Now, suppose the infinite series generated by the sequence Yn converges. Then, see, summation of zeros, you know, that is going to be zero only. Zero plus zero, how many times you are going to add zeros? That's going to be zero. So that will not create any issue. Now here, suppose this bounded above, you can say this bounded above by yn. So it is automatically telling you that if in roughly I will say zero less than equals to summation xn less than equals to summation yn. This will automatically tell you. Okay. Now, what you can from here observe is whenever this series converges, this automatically tells you this series converges. Whenever this series diverges, this series diverges, this will tell you this series diverges. Okay. Right? Because this summation will also behave like a linear fashion. Okay. Integral and so on. It's a monotonic. So xn less than equals to yn here, so that summation xn also less than equals to summation yn. That's the very first thing. Okay. Now if this above sequence will converge, this will definitely converge. Okay. Provided you have these are not the sequence of non-negative real numbers. So suppose you discard this here. Okay. So this suppose you discard this. So what will happen is this bound is not there, so it may diverge towards minus infinity, properly diverge also, which can be possible. So this lower bound is necessary here. You can't have this bound for performing this comparison test. Now, once this diverges, this implies this diverges. If this converges, this implies this converges. Okay, so this is what the return. So then the convergence of summation yn implies the convergence of summation xn. And The divergence of summation xn implies the divergence of summation. Okay, so once you have two sequences satisfying this inequality, then you can discuss about the convergence of both of the sequence or divergence of the both of sequence. Okay, in this fashion. Okay, right. Now, what is other comparison test here is, suppose you have two sequences are strictly positive real sequences. Okay, both sequences are strictly positive real sequences, means none of them is equals to zero, means none of the term is equals to zero, and all are greater than, strictly greater than zero equals. And suppose if you take perform the ratio here xn by yn and you take the limit, okay, so then r, let's say r equals to limit, we have already seen the quotient rule, we know that if x sequence converges and y sequence converges, but where y is a sequence of non-negative real numbers, because it's strictly positive real numbers whose limit is strictly positive, that limit is going to be the x by y in the quotient rule. Okay, so these things are separate things, but we are just relating the algebra of the limits here. Now, suppose both are the sequence are strictly positive real sequence, and suppose that the following limit exists. So this limit exists. So if the limit is non-zero, then they behave in the similar manner. Means, if summation xn converges, summation yn converges. If summation x yn converges, summation xn will converge. Or summation xn diverges, summation yn diverges. Means, what does that mean is, they behave in the similar manner. Means, if it is, means once if you are able to decide about the sequence y, if it converges, let's say, then it's what it is. Comparison test tells you that the limit of x also exists and it converges. We can say converges. Okay, provided the limit is non-zero limit. Okay, so if you are identifying this r as a zero limit, and then you will talk about the denominator, means the another sequence y, if summation yn is convergent, then summation xn is convergent. How to utilize this result in the problems, okay, that we are going to see now. Okay, right, so let's look at some problem. So let's very first problem, discuss the convergence or divergence of the following infinite series. So in this problem, you have been given with the sequence x equals to 1 by m square plus n. You can easily identify, okay, what is the nth term of the sequence, and then you can define the sequence x equals to xn. Okay, right. Now, whether we are able to identify, so that's very, very clear that 0 less than equals to xn. Okay, because n is greater than or equals to 1, so it's always a positive, or you can say strictly greater than 0 for all n. Okay, now can you able to identify a yn? Now we are, suppose we are able to identify a yn such that this summation yn converges, then the comparison test tells you that summation xn will come. So this is a task here, so that you have to create artificially. Okay, now see, you know that whenever a and b are positive, so a plus b is less than equals to 1 by a as well as less than equals to 1 by b, right? So now that's very first thing we can use here to identify the bound. So either you can take yn is equals to 1 by n, or you can take is equals to 1 by n square. Okay, there are two possibilities if you look at this result. Okay, now see, this 1 by n series, we have known that it's a harmonic series and this diverges. So this will not be useful for us. Okay, because whenever summation yn diverges, it will never tell you that summation xn also diverges, because it lies below here. So summation may be finite. Okay, but if summation yn converges, the infinite series generated by yn converges, then it will automatically tell you that the series generated by the sequence xn will also converge. So now look at the next term here. Let's say we are going to utilize this as a yn, 1 by n square, and we know that this infinite series summation 1 by n square converges because of the p test, because p is equals to 2 and 2 is greater than 1. So this converges. So this comparison test tells you that summation xn also converges. So here, to show that this converges, we are going to use this yn as 1 by n square. Okay, right. Now, suppose you want to show that x is diverges, then what you have to show, what you have to find is, you have means suppose I wish to show that this is diverges. So, if you are able to find a sequence yn lies below x, you can say. If summation yn diverges, then summation xn will automatically diverge. So, this is another way to look at here, so for divergence. Okay, right. Now, so this solves our first problem because by using the comparison test one, you can see. Now, what about the next problem? Okay, so let's look at the next problem. Summation n equals to 1 to infinity, 1 by n square minus n plus 1. So I have the second problem is summation n equals to 1 to infinity, 1 upon n square minus n plus 1. Now, if you extract the nth term, xn is equals to 1 by n square minus n plus 1. So that is equals to 1 upon n square minus n minus 1. Now, what can you do about it? Can you identify a bound here? First thing is whether this is greater than 0. This is quadratic equation in n. So you can certainly factorize it. So,
Sir, it will always be positive,
yeah.
and
So,
we can write it's less than 1 upon n square.
are you sure about it? Less
Yes,
than
sir,
1 by
because
n.
n square minus n would certainly be less than 1 upon n square,
Oh,
and if
interesting.
you
So
add
ask
1 to that.
whether, so what we'll see, whenever you are saying n square minus this 1 upon this is less than 1 by n square, means this is greater than n square. But n minus 1 is for n, n is a natural number. Okay, so n minus 1 is greater than equals to 0. So if you are subtracting n from something from n square, it will never be greater than n square, right? So you have this is 1 by n square minus n plus 1. That is going to be equals to 1 by n minus 1 whole square plus 1. Right. So this is certainly less than
So
1 by
plus n.
Sorry, is plus n, yes. So for certainly it is less than n minus 1 whole square. Now, we want to investigate about this series summation 1 upon n minus 1 whole square, n equals to 1 to infinity. So this is going to be n equals to 1 to infinity, you can't define, right? So you can only talk about n equals to 2 to infinity. So you can only see first term, first two term, first term you can discard. So you can talk about n greater than equals to 2. That's the very first thing. Because the comparison test holds, you can accept finitely many terms, you can discard, and rest of the terms you can consider. So here n is greater than equals to 2, because n equals to 1 it is 0 and it is not defined. Okay, right. Now I'm just doing some here, this is going to be, I can write 1 upon k square for k equals to, you can say this starting from, you can say n plus 2, right? If you replace n by n plus 1, so k equals to 1 to infinity. Can I write this as this? The series, the both are the same thing, because it's what is the first term here? 1 plus 1 by 2 square plus 1 by 3 square plus 1 by 4 square plus and so on. Similarly here. So this both series are same. I'm just replacing n by n plus 1. So this series is starting from k equals to 1 to infinity 1 by k square. But we know that this series converges due to the p test. P is greater than 2. So therefore this also series converges. And hence this series converges means this series, this summation xn also converges by using the comparison test. Okay, so what we have done so far is, let's consider the second example. Okay, it's clearly noted that xn is strictly greater than 0. There's no doubt about it. Now we can rewrite the denominator as n minus 1 whole square plus n. Okay, we can add and subtract n here. Okay, then we can rewrite the denominator in this form. Now, since both of the terms in the summation are positive, we can certainly dominate it by less than equals to 1 by n minus 1 whole square for all n less than equals to 2. Now, look at this series now. Summation n equals to 2 to infinity 1 by n minus 1 whole square. So I told you these are the dummy index, right? n equals to 2 to infinity, or you can replace n by k. Okay, they are the dummy indexes. They are varying over the sum. Okay, so this series is 1 plus 1 by 2 square plus 1 by 3 square plus 1 by 4 square plus and so on. So similarly, this series as well. But we know due to the p test implies this converges. Due to the p test. Since p is equals to 2, which is greater than 1. So this series converges, hence summation xn will converge. So that will imply our result. Okay, right. Now let's look at another example. That's 1 by square root of n plus 1. I want to show that summation n equals to 1 to infinity 1 by square root of n plus 1. We know that n plus 1 is positive. So square root of n plus 1 is greater than square root of n. So this implies 1 by square root of 1 by n plus 1 is less than 1 by square root of n plus 1. Now you can show that this series diverges. 0 less than. The way is, if I want to go for another way as well, so if you carefully identify y n is 1 by root n, then if you look at x n by y n, what is that is, you have, this is x n is 1 by root n plus 1, so you have this is square root of n by n plus 1. So it is going to be, if limit, if you are trying to talk about, is it is going to be limit of xn by yn is going to be 1 upon square root of 1 plus 1 by n, which tends to 1 as n tends to infinity. And if you compare, r is a non-zero value, that is 1. Okay, then xn and yn behave in the similar way. So yn is diverges due to the p test. So xn will also diverge. So that test also you can use here. Okay, right. Now the last term here is summation n equals to 1 to infinity 1 by n factorial. Okay, so here you can use the inequality, or you can show by induction that n square is less than n factorial. Okay, so for the fourth problem, we want to see n equals to 1 to infinity 1 by n factorial. Then you can show that by induction that n square is less than n factorial for all n greater than equals to 4. So n equals to 4, that is 16, is less than 24. Okay, For n equals to for we can say that n equals to k, it is result or hold true, then you have to prove it for n equals to k plus 1. So let me write down the steps here once again. So we have assumed that we want to claim is n square is less than n factorial for all n greater than equals to 4. Now result is true for n equals to 4. Let's suppose hold for n equals to k. Then we claim that, okay, so our claim is so our then we want to show we wish to show that result holds true for n equals to k plus 1. Now k plus 1 whole square or k square is greater than k plus 1 for all k greater than equals to 4. Okay, that is can be shown. Okay, this implies k plus 1 factorial is equals to k plus 1 into k factorial, which is greater than k plus 1 into k square, which is greater than k plus 1 into k plus 1, that is equals to k plus 1 whole square. So the result holds true for all n by using principle of mathematical induction. Now once this is true, so this result implies that 1 by n factorial is less than 1 by n square for all n greater than equals to 4. Now note that this series converges due to the p test. So and this is and therefore this series also converges by using the comparison test. Okay, right. So this ends here the infinite series discussion. Okay, the next lecture will be we will start with the limit of functions of the variable that continuity and differentiability. Okay, so we have added here chapter number 3. Okay, then we will look at the chapter number 4.
Okay.
Thank you. Yes.
Sir, then what about the n is equal to 1, 2, and 3?
So as
If
such,
n.
see again, this finitely many terms will not affect the convergence of the series.
Okay.
Okay, so n equals to 1, 2, 3, 4, you can write till 1, 2, 3, 1 by 1 factorial plus 1 by 2 factorial plus 1 by 3 factorial. Plus, if you have some finite number, which what is the meaning of convergence? Convergence means this limit or this infinite sum, the rest of the infinite sum is going to be the finite number. Okay, then finite number can be added to the finite numbers because the all first three terms will sum will be turns out to be finite only.
Yeah.
Okay, so sum of two finite number is always defined and that is going to be finite value only. So that is why the discarding the first finitely many terms, okay, will not affect the convergence of the series. So this is why if you are able to identify a stage after which if you are able to show the comparison in between them, then you can certainly claim that the original series also converges.
Okay, sir.
Okay, right.